On the air, I'll give it another clap.
We're on the air.
Should I turn it off?
Well, no.
I just gave it a spike, right?
Yeah.
That was what I intended.
So when somebody's listening, they're gonna hear the...
Uh-huh, and then they'll, the editor will know that's the place to start. I guess, I take your point that as an editor, I should be lighter on that clapper tab.
Or, yeah, do it before, turn that on after you...
All right, friends, here we are. The agenda is the same as last week. The draft that Eliza sent us a couple of days is different, and it's pretty near, I don't know, it possibly is pretty near the end of the line.
I'm sorry, that was sent a couple of days ago?
Yeah, the one you responded.
Oh, okay. Have those responses been incorporated?
I haven't.
Into a new draft, or?
I have incorporated them. I haven't printed out a new draft for everyone to see, but we can discuss that. There's, most of them were very minor.
Yeah.
And I made those corrections. Didn't hear from everybody, but heard from a number of people. And there's some outstanding questions, and then we're hoping to proceed. But I'm sorry, we interrupted you.
So, all right. You interrupted me on the conversation that we need to start with is how we're going to proceed. And before that, I wanted to remind those of you that are here that the library board at its meeting last week said that if it gets the report at least a week before February 5th, that it's prepared to have a special meeting with the FTF on February 5th. That's a Thursday, which is the usual night for the library board to meet. So that's just a point to take into consideration.
Did they give a date? They said a week before, so it's like 29th?
Well, the week before is the 29th, Thursday, January.
They want at least a week.
The library wants it for a week before meeting with us, and a week before the library's offer is January 29th, which is a week from this Thursday, or something like 9 days from today, the 20th. So if we need to meet next week, and we do meet next week, anyhow, that's what the library said. So if we get finished tonight.
That means if we meet next week, if we finalize at that date, we are okay for that.
For the February 5th.
For the February 5th, because we would give it to them presumably Wednesday or Thursday, which would be a week before.
Right.
So therefore, we can project, yes, we're going to meet next week, and that would be the final.
We may not need to meet next week.
And might not even need to.
Or, that's right, or we may be able to do it by email.
Yeah. Okay.
So that's maybe the main procedural thing that I wanted to mention from the library board. I reported at some length, and Barry and Amy were there at the library board meeting last Thursday on where we are. As for how we're going to do this today, we have, I don't know, 24 pages more or less, and a couple of hours, a little more. I'm proposing that we go through at least letter by letter, and maybe section by section. And if there are concept issues or questions, to bring them up. If there are editorial suggestions, then let's leave them for Eliza to capture as she goes through the draft. Now, this is what I propose. If this is okay with everybody, we can start in section by section. If you want to go in some other way, we can maybe do that. Seem okay?
Yep. Sounds good to me.
Sounds good.
Let's do it.
All right.
You have a printed copy of the new version?
I did. Well, the version that Eliza sent, was it like Friday? Did you send it on Friday? Thursday?
Yeah, Friday morning.
Friday morning. Okay, so I printed it out.
Saturday? Yeah, Saturday.
It was
Saturday
easier morning for me to make notes on a paper one.
I did.
Yeah. Okay, so Section 1A, Executive Summary of the Recommendations to the FTF. Maybe we can take Section 1 altogether, A and B, because we gave it a lot of attention last week.
Yep.
Eliza, are there major changes, or that you just changed the order?
There were some changes. I think I went into some detail in the email. We changed some wording, but we didn't change the format, and there was still a fair amount of back and forth about the format last week. We ended up keeping it in the same format with some different changes in wording. Nobody raised any issues on the wording. So I guess it's speak now or hold your peace.
Okay. To keep us moving along, silence is going to mean assent to me, and I'm going to...
That's my thing.
Move us along.
Did you want to talk about that?
Do you need some technical adjustments?
We can't open.
So she's going to go run us hard copies.
Okay.
Add a couple things in here.
Yeah, I added one thing.
I did my reading over the weekend, not my computer, which could open it.
I added...
Well, how about if we...
I didn't add the other one because I thought it was repetitive.
I think that there's an addition that's not on anything we're looking at. You should mention what it is.
Okay, I am. I mean...
But there might be a lot...
When we get to it?
Okay.
Or you can...
I will try to do that.
Okay, let's try.
You know, I mean, a lot of different people had suggestions. Most of them were very minor. I incorporated them. If they were really minor, I didn't even make a note of it. Adding a word, little flexible space, didn't seem like a controversial thing to do. So I, you know, if you want me to...
It was almost words.
You added what?
It says, for instance, under this second part, for instance, the existing library is Eliza had overcrowded, and I asked her to add...
With a little flexible space.
So it's really kind of such minor tweaking that any comments I made were not a heck of a lot.
I did a lot of capitalization based on your comments.
Yeah, I told her... I told
architect
her,
to be...
Well, I said architect master plan... should be capitalized because they're individual, they're entities. That's all.
What I'm going to suggest is that we don't talk about it at that level of detail. And this is an example. So that, but I'm. It's okay to do that at this moment because Amy is down making a couple.
Let's talk about Amy
copies.
Instead.
Well, I just assume start moving on to the background section.
Okay.
I have one thing I wanted to say about. Section B.
Okay.
The call for change in tone here.
Mm-hmm.
While this is outside the specific scope of the FTF, we hope that this document will serve as the basis for dialogue going forward. Second sentence, for the past year, the debate over the annex has been heated. Good. Third sentence, positions have hardened as disagreements have grown ever more personal. Consensus and comedy can only be reached when score settling and personnel attacks come to end. I'd like to see those two sentences struck. Because it's a characterization of where things are currently, which I don't think is particularly accurate, or is kind of presumptive about, because we really don't know that positions have hardened. Some people's positions have softened. Other people are pleased with what the FDF is going, and whereas they weren't before, etc. There's a lot of flux in that, so I would like this not to be set in stone, those two sentences.
What do others think? Oh, were you not done, Tim?
No, that's basically it.
Let me check around the table, then we'll make this decision and move on.
For me, I'm not in disagreement. I had a little bit of question about needing very much of this anyway, but when it says positions have hardened as disagreements have grown ever more personal, I think the atmosphere has gotten to be softer. If anything, it hasn't grown any worse.
So are you willing to strike those two sentences?
Yes,
we want to move along briskly tonight.
How about if we just strike the first sentence? Since the second sentence and the first sentence are not the same.
Mm-hmm.
Well, it's not the first sentence of the paragraph. You're talking about the third.
Position.
The sentence beginning, positions have hardened.
Mm-hmm.
If I strike that, would that be suspicion?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I would strike the score settling and personal attacks thing, you know, come to an end. I think it's just...
That doesn't seem like a debatable point. I mean, that we all agree that that's true, right? So why would that need to be struck?
I think it's a positive note. You know, mm-hmm. I think that there is personal attacks going on, and mm-hmm. I think it's like we need to get past that point.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So how about if we just get rid
of
the first of the two sentences?
Yeah, the first one, it's debatable. So some got worse, some got better.
Right.
So
good enough.
Everybody done. Okay with that?
Done.
Great.
Fine.
Is that all right?
Okay. One section down.
Thanks, Tim.
Thanks.
Now, let's look at section two, background. Can we take, it's two pages, A through E. You're welcome to have a look at this.
Oh, thank you.
I'm just going to reach for...
I'm pretty familiar with it, yes.
Yeah, of course you are.
Can you open those documents?
I just found out, just not hers.
Oh, you haven't?
No, I read them over the weekend. I'm just saying I can't open them on my iPad.
Oh, okay.
Oh, okay.
It's an iOS thing.
And that was Amy's issue too.
Yes, she's running a hard copy downstairs.
How about this?
You were my favorite editor.
Thank you.
How about this, background? A, B, C, D, and E?
Nobody had any suggestions about A. Nobody had any suggestions about B, that I recall. C, I think was the same. Amy asked that we make a note that she's a non-voting member of the FTF, although since we didn't have any votes, I'm not sure what that means, but I added that to the
the footnote.
Mm-hmm. We get a couple.
I'd like to say something. So we're talking about the Friends of the Library now, because we're kind of up to that.
Okay.
There have been some remarks made in the past 2 weeks. Last week at the board meeting, and in an email that Ken Panza sent out yesterday, for some reason the public thinks, and I think this is important for the public to hear, for some reason the public thinks that we're building something for the Friends. That's not true. We're building something for the library. The Friends are part of the library, so they move into one of the spaces that we have here. Right now they're using the barn. So we're not building anything for the Friends, Ken. Okay, do you understand that?
Gary, if I could ask you...
Yeah,
but if I could ask you to focus on the text...
Well, the focus on the text is Friends of the Woodstock Library, which is what we're on.
Uh-huh.
And I'm disturbed that people are saying that it's illegal, that there are illegal ramifications of the Friends having something built for them. We're not building anything for the Friends. I think the public needs to know that. We're building something for the library, and the Friends use the space.
So do you want some change in the text to reflect that?
No, but I'd like the public to understand that concept.
But if we can move on, this isn't a great moment for that.
Okay. I didn't hand this out, but everybody should have a chance to look at it. It's not for another section, but it speaks to what Barry's talking about. This is our program space, estimated program space required, and you'll see that how we arrived at 4,500 doesn't include anything for the Friends of the Library. So that will be, that is, we make it clear in this document several times to that effect, Mary, and this chart will be in there as well. So I think that that's spoken to.
Thanks. Well, are we done with section, whatever this is, section 2 background? That takes us through zoning to... Well, it takes us through
assets.
To assets, section 3, if we're okay with section 2. Good. So let's look at assets. Is that a really long section?
No, but there were some changes to it.
Okay, so 3, assets. Let's go through that.
Okay. The library green, Maria wanted to add a thing at the end of the second paragraph, saying, let's see where it comes to.
Second paragraph, starting with the FTF bassoons.
Yeah. The current ADA compliance. She wanted to add something at the end of that paragraph to say that any additions to the south elevation, as you know, she's advocated that we do more than one addition. Any additions to the south elevation of the library, she wants to take out, she thought we were being too specific when we said, this recommendation does not limit the option to add a small addition to the front of the building or a modest expansion of the southern edge of the library. She didn't like small and modest. She thought that was too specific. So, and I think that's a fair point. And she wanted to add, take those words out and add, any additions to the south elevation of the library would likely be secondary in square footage to the north wing, as the northern elevation is the largest and thus most cost-effective site available. The southern elevation, however, provides an opportunity for architectural expression as well as some program space fulfillment.
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 And is that in place, taking two sentences?
No, we're not taking anything out other than those two, the words small and modest. and then adding it.
Small addition and modest expansion.
I don't have any feelings one way or the other. I'm throwing it out there for discussion about it.
I would be more comfortable just taking out those two words and not adding all that other text.
Okay, how do other people feel about it?
I'm okay with the text, but I'd like to make sure that the readers realize that this is a challenge for the architect that's hired and not for this group. In other words, we're not saying we're going to do that. It's more just a message to the architect.
Okay, so there's another idea to add another sentence. People want to react to either of those two things?
What paragraph are you looking at?
The second paragraph, part three, part A, number one, second paragraph, we'd be adding a couple of sentences at the end.
The paragraph break is hard
part
to
three
spot
assets.
Because there's no line break. So it's the paragraph that begins the FTF assumes.
Yeah. It's the sixth line down, Barry.
Yeah.
You do have this, though.
Well, this is last week's.
Yeah.
What we're considering now is, let's see, I think we have agreement on taking out small addition and modest expansion. Is that right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Sure.
We've got that settled. Now, Maria proposed a couple of sentences of text, and I think Joe proposed a third sentence to go with hers.
Somebody want me to read
again? Sean said he preferred not to have Maria's elaboration of the possibility for construction on the south side. That's meant to be a recap of where the conversation...
Could we hear these three sentences one more time?
Yep.
The Joe sentences?
Any additions to the south elevation of the library would likely be secondary in square footage to the north wing, as the northern elevation is the largest and thus most cost-effective site available. The southern elevation, however, provides an opportunity for architectural expression as well as some program space fulfillment.
Then Joe wanted to add to that.
Of course, this would be left... of course, this would be something that the master plan architect would attack.
And that's what Joe wanted to add.
So we're just saying it's like a suggestion, not a conclusion.
Right. This is a.
I like the suggestion. I have to say about it.
I have a problem with it in the sense that we really haven't. We really haven't created any charts for more than one addition. We've paid lip service to it. We know that if you build two small additions, it's probably more expensive than building one large addition. So it's a thought that Maria has continually advocated for, and nobody else has really jumped on board. So I wonder if it accurately reflects our views.
I think it accurately reflects our intention that the
architect
and architect not be. We're not giving him specific direction.
Right.
And back only, don't even look at the front.
Right.
So if we're giving him that flexibility, I think we shouldn't hesitate to articulate it.
Yeah. Okay. How about you guys?
Marty?
Marty had something. Did you?
I was just going to say, I thought we were going to say, look at the campus.
We are. Right. And that's what he would do. But and Maria's just pointing out that, gee, we could do something in front. It could be architecturally significant. And that, to me, that's not contrary to what we're saying. In other words, the master plan architect could propose anything that he sees, discovers, that would be advantageous as one of the options.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it could be at a second floor to one of the appendages.
So it's more about the thought than the wording, because I'll deal with the wording, which is not optimal right now. But so it's about the thought.
What Joe said, first of all,
Tim, Marty was next after Barry, and then if we could get back to you, we can stay with this.
I think we should acknowledge the ability to build, and indeed perhaps the need to build in front. We may or may not consider, and I want us to think about this for a moment, if there's any historical place on the campus, it's going to be the doctor's front. Which the architect would have to deal with in some way, because that would be the location of any potentially, or probably that would be the location of an addition. I don't know whether we want to indicate that we recognize the historical significance of the doctor's, of the front of the doctor's office. We may or may not. I don't think we have to worry about the charts relating to what we're proposing. It could very well be this master plan architect is going to find that he doesn't want to do a full box back there. I hate to say box back there, but fill out that full full footprint. He might want to add parking. Who knows what he comes up with. I think we really have to acknowledge that, yes, one of the alternatives could be, and he should think about, the front. So I would basically, I think, just about leave what she's saying, maybe slightly moderate it, but it's close enough for government work at this point, I think.
Would you be okay with that?
Tim?
Just a second. Yeah, I agree with Joe. I think it indicates that nothing's off the table in terms of that particular asset. The library green is on the table in terms of development. One thing, bouncing off what you just said, Marty, was that, and we'll get to it in number three of this section, the main library building does have a certain kind of nostalgic and aesthetic meaning to people. We might want to talk about that a little bit somehow in this report. We've mentioned it a number of times, it's been brought to us a number of times, that the old residents and, you know, the iconic nature of the front of the building has some meaning to people.
A couple of paragraphs hence.
ADA compliance is absolutely important, I think, in this section, so this is...
Well, where are we?
Probably not in the library green section.
Maria's addition to the library green, just a sec. Barry was the next to...
I just wanted to admit that we were in process of trying to get a grant to redo the entrance to make it ADA compliant, because there was a grant available for that, and I guess that got held up like everything else. So, but it's something that we've talked about for years now.
Mm-hmm. Okay, but that's not something you want to add into the report, right?
No, it doesn't have to be in the report.
Wasn't there a graph at one point that was for the wings?
Yes.
Yeah,
our graph does cover wings.
Okay.
It's really, but we're mostly, we pay lip service to it, I suppose, mm-hmm. rather than delve into it. But our graph does say, or it used to, it doesn't say it anymore. It used to have a parentheses S.
We can do that. It's really truly meant to do that because when you design, there may be a very logical reason to take some of the space out of the back and put it another place.
Right. Yeah.
Just to make things work better.
Okay, so we'll correct that on the... On
and I'll change the graph, too.
Okay.
Okay.
So let's leave the wording the way it is and just add a sentence that to be determined by the master plan architect.
Yeah, I'll kind of
move on.
Fiddle with it and send something out. If you guys feel strongly you want to see it again or you feel comfortable, that I'll come up with some thought that essentially says this, but possibly slightly different wording.
I get the point. Now we've come to an interesting point in the life of the facilities task force. Sean has said he doesn't want to see that language in, and others have said it's okay.
Stuart is fine.
Okay.
That was the little moment we had when you asked me if I wanted to speak, which she was saying, would that be okay with you, based on the
Sean and I have our quiet little moments to ourselves all
well,
the time.
But I missed it because...
No, I appreciate you checking in, Stuart. We're fine moving on.
Okay, good. So,
okay.
Yes.
Great. All right. Book barn.
So book barn, main library.
Marty had some suggestions. He would like to say at the end of the first paragraph of the book barn, he'd like to add the sentences, the book barn's 1,173 square foot footprint lies on 2,500 square feet of land, and there's another 950 square feet available for expansion in the northeast corner of the property. He wanted to add that.
And the,
mm-hmm.
I think it's
the reason for that adding was it's indicating that that plot of land is underutilized at this point, even as a first floor, and that there is the additional northeast corner.
Mm-hmm. I think that's good.
Yeah,
that does. Are those calculations? Are there any setbacks in those calculations, or is that taking right to the property lines, those square footage points?
Oh, nothing includes the setbacks. The setback requirements.
Well, I know not code setback. That has been any setback.
No, it's strictly taking, if you take that box of the,
mm-hmm.
and come through the...
Marty, I think we understand, so let me, in the interest of...
2,500 square feet plus 950.
That is to say I got Sean
gotcha.
Understood.
Okay.
And if...
So everybody's okay with
if
that?
If we're okay with Marty's suggestion.
Oh, yeah, sounds great.
Terrific. Thank you, Marty.
Good catch, Marty. All right, main library building. Amy was not part of the walkthrough, so I'm taking her name out. And otherwise, I think there were just a few tiny tweaks, nothing major that needs to be talked about.
Okay.
Do you want me to just be leading the way here?
Well, yeah.
Okay.
And then if there's conversation.
6 Library Lane, let's see. There was a slight change in wording about utility lines crossing the property rather than utility pole and land, but really it's really unchanged. Environmental regulatory...
No, five. There's more than five cars. You had
six parking spaces. You have to change that.
There's about
right?
six parking
yeah,
spaces.
Yeah, I guess, I mean, there are six
Probably
six
seven.
Cars parked there, but I was going... I went back to your notes about it's supposed to be 10 feet and everything, so it really should be five spaces. I mean, I can put in whatever you want, but...
Number six gets the opportunity of running into the utility pole. That's all.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I mean, I didn't pull five out of the top, you know. I mean, you're the one who said you need 10 feet per spot, right?
And I think there's 70 foot of frontage minus one for the pole. I thought that meant six. Five or six.
Okay.
Just
I mean, is there,
leave
so,
it.
Are we okay with five? Good. Moving along.
Leave it five.
Are we going to cover number three, main library building?
Number three?
Main library building.
Yeah, we just did.
We just did. Is there something
we're
you
in it now.
I haven't heard any notes from you on that.
Uh-huh.
Did you have some notes on that?
I have no notes on it, but I had mentioned it when we were talking about number one, the library green.
Okay.
So when we're talking about, before I suggest anything, the purpose of this asset section is to do what? Is there a scope for it in terms of what it's mentioning? And I had mentioned something about the sort of the iconic...
Tim, maybe if you have a suggestion, you could make it rather than asking a kind of general question that could take us a few
okay,
minutes to
well,
answer.
Okay, well, I'm just going to assume that this is relevant then.
Good.
A lot of people have mentioned that the look of the existing building is part of what the library is, part of what the library means to them. For instance, somebody who likes the small town look of the library likes the small town look of the. Of the front of the building. So I'm just wondering whether anything about the historic nature of the facade of the front of the library needs to be mentioned in this at all.
I would say it's outside the scope of the FTF, and it's the job for the master plan architect. I mean, our job is to solve space problems, not to...
Good enough. We have had meetings about architectural... Maria said something about the meaning of architecture.
Mm-hmm.
And so if the particular front of the building has a meaning for the town,
mm-hmm.
That's why I brought this up. But if this is just functional, if this is just a functional document about space and facilities, then it's not needed. But if what Maria was bringing to our group has any meaning, then this does have relevance.
Mm-hmm. Marty had something to say about
this. In talking about the front of the building with Richard Heppner, who is the town historian, he's indicated that if there's any place that has any significance, it would be the front of the doctor's office. In conversation with him about potential adding on, he said he, as a member of CCD, and he was speaking as an individual, but the way he would feel with CCD, he would want to protect that facade. Mm-hmm. I said, well, one could consider relocation, which was something Maria had mentioned many years ago.
Mm-hmm.
And that's more or less the way it ended. But certainly we... Within Woodstock, there's only five properties on the historic registry of the state, and we don't even have a historic district. So I just want that's by way of information. I don't think we really have to mention too much about it. That will come up.
It is in Maria's report.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that's good.
That time
to be. Would you like there to be an FAQ about it, or would you like to speak to it and add it to our editorial page?
Not sure whether I have anything to add to it. I'm not an advocate
so much as I'm just trying to make sure that it has a voice.
I think it's in the report, and also we're saying that it's, we're not preservationists here.
Yeah,
we're saying if there's a functional thing that really could be built, we'd figure it out. The building's been chopped up over the years, so we're not into preservation, we're more into functionality.
Mm-hmm.
But it is mentioned in Maria's report, and it's noted here a couple times about just the way the town feels about the building.
Okay,
moving on.
Okay, thank you. Eliza, number 4, 6 Library Lane. I think you just were on that, as a matter of fact.
Said that. We're going to change the 6 parking spaces to 5, and that's really it. I mean, there was nothing major changed to be changed in that. The environmental regulatory requirements section, there are some substantive changes to that. Essentially, if you look at the bullet points, we're going to say that instead of using bullets, I use numbers, and the second and third points above are regulations taken from the Woodstock Wetlands and Watercourse Law.
This is a text you're adding?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Since there is a buildable location in the rear of the library that is not regulated by points 2 and 3 above, the annex design does not appear to meet those criteria to build beyond the existing laundromat footprint. There was also the added expense of stabilizing the stream bed and mitigating the detrimental impact of the proposed pier footings themselves. Those costs would be avoided if the library chose to build on the other side of Library Lane instead. And then it goes back to the regular text.
At what point?
It goes back to the additional reasons. Yeah. So.
Oh, okay. So that something was sort of stuck in.
Yeah,
did that replace the first sentence?
Yeah, it's that's correct.
All right. Is there any discussion about this new section on the first first sentence of this paragraph? Yeah. Marty, go ahead.
I think instead of saying the other side of Library Lane, instead I think it should say the main campus side or something to be just clearer.
Okay.
I know that's a bit wordsmithy.
Mm-hmm. No, that's fine. Okay.
Any other comments about what Eliza just read, which is the present draft, though you don't have it in front of you? Thanks, Eliza.
Okay.
Moving on.
Zoning, and the zoning section was one that I think Joe and I just wrote up a 1 or 2 sentence summary because we didn't have a summary from Marty, but he has provided one. So I do have some significant changes to that section.
I want to start with what you're omitting.
Yeah.
If there's anything in these two paragraphs.
The first sentence is the same. That Marty did the... Would you like it to be Martin, not Marty, by the way?
Martin. If you're mad at me, Martin, I don't care. Okay. Martin. Okay, call it Martin.
okay.
If one of my wife's mad at me, she calls me Martin when it's...
okay, so
Martin's happy, it's Marty.
Martin. Okay. Okay. The next... So the first sentence remains the same. Just ignore the rest of the next couple sentences. The library campus is site-constrained with limited areas for expansion. Analysis of the zoning resolution, parentheses, code, for the main campus shows that the existing structures have, for the most part, built out all the space available under the code. At least 3 of the 4-year... At least 3 of the 4-yard setbacks and the parking layout and the quantity of parking are not in compliance. The code was enacted after all present construction occurred. Grandfathering, an increase in the floor area allowance, and use of the existing yard conditions is required. New paragraph. We believe that the laundromat site is in full compliance with the exception of the side yard, 2 feet instead of the required 10 feet, and the parking layout. We believe that the replacement of the existing footprint at grade is allowable by grandfathering, and a second story, an option unaddressed by the MOU, may be possible. This analysis of zoning leads the FTF to conclude that the site of the Book Barn is the most logical expansion site. Any addition should make the most efficient use of the available land, and one-story buildings are not an efficient use of limited space.
That's not really zoning, those last two, but...
Well, that was... We had to put it somewhere.
Let's look around the table. What do people think of this new text at the bottom of zoning?
I think it's fine.
Anybody have any problems with it? Does it say what it needs to say?
I think I'm happy with it. It's close enough. You can, if anybody wants further information, they go into the main body.
I think further information is too technical. You know, I think you got it, and that's enough.
Okay.
And you got, and this, the zoning report's an attachment, right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Did you want to say something?
Okay.
Everybody's all right with that? Okay.
Next section.
Next section, we're up to needs.
We can start with A, methodology, and maybe go on.
I don't know that there's any changes to needs from what, until you get to additional meeting space required. The first three sections, first three paragraphs, there were no suggested changes. The graph, I brought the graph because...
So I want to go back of the envelope estimates.
This is the graph that's going to be attached. If anybody wants to look at it more closely.
Sure, I can't read it.
You're not allowed to see it more closely, Stuart, sorry.
You call it a graph, though. It looks like a
it's a spreadsheet, table. Yeah.
Whatever, I don't know.
It is. It's a table.
Okay.
It's a graphic table.
Okay. Well, I just didn't know if you were going to tell Excel to make a graph.
I believe in Pennsylvania we call those thingamajigs.
It's an info non-graphic.
Okay. The only changes came to the additional meeting space required, where we're trying to clarify that there's a difference between library meeting and makerspace and community meeting space, which I think is a issue that we've talked about and is certainly a thing that keeps coming up. I was kind of disappointed with Jeremy's comment in the Woodstock Times 2 weeks ago about how, well, there's a lot of community meeting space has come online recently, and maybe the library should just stick to being a library. When I think the library has done a pretty effective job of explaining that flexible meeting and makerspace is what a library is. But clearly that message hasn't reached everyone. So I think this is a place for that. And we've added some text. The proposed text replaces what's under number 3. Currently the programs and services that the library offers are limited by lack of space. The library does not have an accessible space to use for library programs during library hours. Children's programs are held upstairs. While that area is an adequate size, it is not ADA accessible and it lacks certain features. Last year there were 3 groups that used the director's office, 2 writing workshops, and the book discussion group. When these groups meet, the director is displaced from her office. When the library has more space, the community will benefit from all the additional programs the library will be able to offer for all ages. While the Woodstock Library does not currently have a meeting room, the library makes space available to groups after library business hours. There are groups using the library after hours 6 days a week. The library receives frequent requests for use of a meeting room. Those requests must often be denied for lack of space. Providing free, neutral meeting space in the public library is a standard service in modern libraries. One of the 3 priorities identified in a recent library planning process was to, quote, ensure the facility meets the needs of the community for neutral meeting space and present and emerging technology, end quote. The Woodstock Library believes that offering space for community connections fulfills our mission to facilitate learning and self-education. So that would be the new proposed text, and the question...
For the whole section 3.
Right, and the question is, should that just be the end of it, or should we still use the text that then have follow it with the paragraph that you already have in front of you? So feel free to weigh in. Or if you should edit that down.
So let's take those suggestions one at a time. Should we add what Eliza just said, read, as the first part of the meeting space required, section 3?
I would say yes, and I would add to it. When we talk about the future of libraries, I think we concluded that the common strain was that there's more bodies in the library for a certain reason. So I think that's important, some of the work that in, that there's just, the population any given time is higher, because people are here for different reasons, library reasons, not just meeting space. But I think it's good to separate the need for more meeting space that's town-wide, and the need for more meeting space
that's
library program space, because mm-hmm. that is undeniable, and it shouldn't go anywhere else.
Right. So the question is, should we take out this bit about, well, in the meantime, the library, you know, while they're rethinking this master plan thing, should the maybe the library could use the other community meeting space?
I was suggesting that we hold that discussion for a second and talk about the text that you read,
okay.
and then we'll get back to that in just a second of the what to do with the paragraph that's here. And Marty had a comment.
I think we have to read it again slowly, because it was, and I think since there's a question of adding this to, let's read it, start at the top of what this is, and then run on through. But I don't know that I heard comments about on-site being so important. I didn't hear on-site in here, and I think that's really a very crucial thing. We need on-site meeting space for it to be part of the library. We can't be going off-site. Yes, for 65, maybe for 65 people, but certainly for 35 people or the 10 person, we need these smaller spaces flexible to open up into a larger space, equating to 45, 55, whatever number of people are required. So I'd like to just read right from the top and listen for, does it say on-site?
Just a sec, before you do that, Eliza, is there any other comments that we can make now so that people can be listening for that?
Okay. Tim, did you had something you
Yeah, that's Tim in particular.
Point,
no. I was
okay. Not in this point.
All right.
I'd like to hear the passage again.
And the as I understand it,
pause for each sentence if you could do it that too. You know,
Eliza, if I understand right, this is becomes the beginning after number three, additional meeting space required, and then it starts off with what you're going to read.
Yeah, this is what it would say right off the bat.
Mm-hmm.
Currently, the programs and services that the library offers are limited by lack of space. We could just say limited by space.
But just read it straight and then...
Right, limited by lack of space. Yeah. The library does not have an accessible space to use for library programs during library hours. Does not have an accessible, mm-hmm. flexible meeting space? Okay, something.
Sure.
To use during library hours. Children's programs...
flexible meeting space.
Right. Children's programs are held upstairs, and while that area is an adequate size, it is not ADA accessible, and it lacks certain features. Last year, there were three groups that used the director's office, two writing workshops, and the book discussion group. When these groups meet, the director is displaced from her office. When the library has more space, the community will benefit from all the additional programs that the library will be able to offer for all ages. New paragraph. While the Woodstock Library does not currently have a meeting room, the library makes space available to groups after library business hours. There are groups using the library after hours 6 days a week. The library receives frequent requests for use of a meeting room. Those requests must often be denied for lack of space. Providing free, neutral meeting space in the public library is a standard service in modern libraries. One of the three priorities identified in a recent library planning process was to, quote, ensure the facility meets the needs of the community for neutral meeting space and present and emerging technology, end quote. The Woodstock Library believes that offering space for community connections fulfills our mission to facilitate learning and self-education.
Mm-hmm. So the question right before us right now is to add that or something close to it in here under additional meeting space.
I have one input here, which is that when one of the problems with the current meeting space, or one of the things that will solve, a new facility will solve, is there'll be more program time, not only just space. It's sort of implied when you say that three groups meet in the director's office and that some people are meeting after hours, but if you actually say that there'll actually be more time,
mm-hmm.
it'll be during hours, after hours, whatever.
Do you want to say
that's
anything?
That's an important point to make.
Okay. Do you want to say anything about I mean, one of the things about that study was meeting space that's accessible, that the rest of the library collections are not vulnerable.
Mm-hmm.
Do you want to add something about that?
It's getting a little specific.
You could say...
Well, I mean, yeah. It'd be nice if people were taking the five-finger discount out of the art section on their way home, mm-hmm. right? I mean...
Yeah.
Okay.
You could say assuring security or something like that.
Something about security.
Yeah, that was my only edits, yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Any other thoughts?
Just on-site, at least twice a year.
Yep. Okay, so I'll take a... I'll do some wordsmithing on
adding
that.
Now, yep. The question is, what should we do with the paragraph that's in there now that starts the FTF agrees?
Basically has a recommendation about, maybe the library, it just says maybe the library could use, you know, some of the other community space while this is being built. And maybe that is outside of our scope. So the question is, do you think it needs to be in there?
I don't think that needs to be in there.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I think we have, go ahead, Tim.
When we're ready to move on, I have something about the structure.
Good, we're here now. Are you agree with us, with everyone else, to cut that one paragraph?
It's a great paragraph.
Great paragraph to keep. This last paragraph, everyone else,
okay. Oh, no.
Everyone else is saying
has said
cut
we
it.
Can ditch.
Oh, I'm very sorry. Paragraph. I was concentrating on something else.
Buy another beer.
Uh-huh. Just disregard what I said.
I don't know if I lose the whole paragraph. I think we should acknowledge that there's more meeting space coming online with the community center, because I don't want people to read this and say, well, didn't they realize, you know, this, this, and this? So if we say there is new meeting space coming on with the community center and the Christian Science Room, however...
But library space is different.
You know, there's still a need for library-specific meeting space.
The other option is I could take that question... And move it to the frequently asked questions about, like, well, there's a community center now. What does the library need meeting space for? And address it there.
It could be both places.
Do we know that it's going to be for free for public use, the community center?
No.
We don't know that, but there's an availability.
Before.
In other words,
but people like us because we're free.
Yeah, you always make that distinction. But some of them, when people talk about the town needing more meeting space, they don't.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? So... I think we should mention that they do come, that there is availability for meeting space for other functions, but the library function can't move mm-hmm. to those.
Okay, so Marty had an observation.
I believe the community center is not really divisible, so it's really for large uses.
But it's not used that much either, so.
But it's large function, yeah. So you wouldn't put 10 people in that. You wouldn't heat it for 10 people. And this on-campus thing, I think,
the
is really...
The Christian Science, they won't heat it. It's not heated in the winter.
I was talking about the community center. I just meant that it's not really an inducive space or a good space for a smaller meeting. It's going to be a huge room. And even the dividing wall, I think, they've taken out of the budget. Not that it might not go back, but...
Here's what I would love. I would love to see. I really like your little tying it back in some more simply into this section. I think I'd love to see it stay here rather than move to the FAQ.
Okay.
But just much more simplified than it currently than its current state.
Uh-oh.
So
just, people okay with me taking another stab at it?
Do.
I think so. I'm looking around the table. Mm-hmm. So will you redo this paragraph with our comments?
Okay.
Okay, great. Moving on
I would like to see...
Section. Or you want to talk about
it,
number three, or
yes,
you already got
number
four?
Yes, about number three. In terms of the community space, distinguishing the kind of library meetings that would happen in the library from the kind of meetings that have happened or will happen at the community center, I think is important. I think a lot of things that happen here, not only would our facilities not be available, not only would they not be... Is it hard to move... meetings that would happen naturally here over to the community center, but people actually would not expect the kind of meeting that happens here to happen at the community center, and they wouldn't even ask the town for it in the first place, I don't think. A small meeting, for instance, that
Jim, do you think that's covered by the text that Eliza added at the beginning of this, the two paragraphs there?
I think so. I'm going to assume that it is. When I see it, I'll know.
Okay. Thanks for the thought, and thanks for underlining that.
One last one. Do any of these meetings that want to be held on site or how many of them involve equipment. In other words, you can't move equipment to a community center, be it computers or other...
Or librarians.
Well, that's what I wanted to say. Having had library programs off-site in the past, in the community center, for example, it's terribly inconvenient, and it's a pain, and we stopped doing it. And that's how it ended up in the director's office, because there was too much back and forth, and there was too much confusion. It was a library program. We were in the community center. Just, it comes with a certain amount of hassle.
Okay. Which is?
I think we're set on that and ready to move to C, parking.
Okay. Other than changing the... No, I don't think there were any changes to parking.
D, library campus needs. Let's go paragraph one, program square footage.
Okay. I don't think anybody had any...
In the bullets.
Had any...
I have a comment.
Oh, okay.
Thanks,
Amy. I don't know if I was out of the room when you mentioned this, but... Just for...
Oh, I switched everything to JSA.
Oh,
is that
okay.
What you're,
yeah. Yes,
thanks. Joel Sanders, architect, is the official name, so mm-hmm. I used that the first time, and then from then on I used JSA.
Perfect. That's how they referred to. Good.
In the bullets, I asked this to Timmy.
Marty,
yeah.
You want to...
Which one?
Tell us all, or...
Well, Eliza said there were no changes, but I had asked for a change.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
In the second bullet... The last sentence says, however, we feel it would not be advisable to have a new public assembly building designed to only be AD accessible by way of a mechanical lift. Well, it is a legal way to do it, and I don't know that we should be putting our opinion. What does it have to do with being a public assembly building? I think we should just strike that. I think we should strike that whole sentence.
Suggesting we strike the last sentence there.
We don't need. I don't think we need to say it.
However, we feel to mechanical lift, right? Take that last.
I think we should take that last sentence out
of the middle bullet point.
Correct.
How do other people feel?
How do other people feel?
There was.
I know how you feel.
Yeah, there was some people that spoke up about discriminating unnecessarily. You know, with people with accessibility problems, and they talked about, you know, it should be made easy in a new building and not an afterthought where you walk around the back or you get online, you know.
Joe, could you say whether you thought we should take that sentence out or leave it in?
I think the thought...
Well, Joe wrote it, so I know he has to leave it in.
So I think it's good.
And then Amy and Marty.
Yeah, I just think it... one of the things we talked about is it would be hard to have a mechanical lift when you have a lot of people going over there. And I think that's worth discussing. I don't know if maybe we should change not advisable to, you know, something softer. I think we talked about before it's a poor practice, and then we took that out and said, well, it's not advisable. But I don't know. I don't think it would be a favor to people not to have, you know, ramps, building that's not ramp accessible.
We are not going to have a building that's not
okay,
ramp
so
accessible.
I have Amy, Marty,
I mean, I agree with
Eliza,
you.
And Tim.
That's what you wanted to say?
Because the lift is always broken.
Yeah.
Right, like we just went to the Phoenicia Library's grand opening. Guess what? The elevator didn't work. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I've been to a lot of places where, you know, you read about it, they use it for storage, and then somebody comes and needs it, and they're embarrassed because maintenance people have to come and they empty it out. I mean, it's just like not a favorite thing of people, to say the least.
Joe, let's go around the table.
Okay.
And I'll come back to you if you want. The question is whether to take out this one sentence. Marty, Eliza, and Tim.
I suggested taking it out. I acquiesce. I don't think it's a big deal. I was here when Randy Steele was the one hollering about going in the back, and I recognize that I believe that a ramp maybe takes away from lot coverage and maybe it's not needed, but certainly to the point of not just those that are disabled, but also just for service access to and from things, a ramp is better than a lift, and I agree that they do break. So if you don't want to take it out, leave it in. This is not worth our time talking about. I'd say leave it in. Let's move on.
Well, thanks. We have Eliza and Tim at least before we move on, but and then Barry.
I'd like to leave it in, only because I'm picturing, you know, 40 people at a event that's, let's say, appeals to seniors, and, you know, 25 of them, you know, can't use the stairs, and are they going to wait two by two to go down the lift for an hour and a half? I mean, I just can't see a building being built for the library that's not the most accessible. I mean, the whole idea is accessibility. So.
Thanks, Eliza. Tim?
I think the paragraph could be restructured to express exactly what Joe and Eliza and everybody's been
Tim,
been
what
mentioning.
We're talking about now is removing that sentence or leaving it in.
I think the paragraph. Yes, I think the paragraph needs a rewrite. I should basically, due to the requirements, the raised foundation adjacent to the stream, 2 feet clear under the building, both solutions for ADA compliance are difficult or unacceptable or pose hardship for the disabled. A mechanical, then you go on to say the ramp would be X feet long. You've either got a choice of a long ramp or mechanical lift. Neither of them are favorable for the disabled. And that way you basically take the two solutions, put them side by side, and make the people that the ADA compliance is supposed to serve at the front of the structure of the paragraph.
Thanks, Tim. Barry.
My question is, if we're going to be hiring an architect to design what the building looks like, why are we advising the architect what we need and don't need? Isn't it up to the architect as to whether it should be there or not be there?
This section is a critique of the JSA design.
Mm-hmm.
And so this is we're considering a criticism or comment about the JSA design. Amy?
I don't see any place in here where it states that the design was in design development. It kind of assumes that everything was a done deal and everything was set in stone. So to criticize something that we never even got to maybe modifying is a little...
Okay, so what about... the first sentence under one, would it be the annex as laid out in the design development stage per... JSA, is that what you want to have it say? Something like that?
Yeah, I'd like it noted that that's where we were in the process.
Design development. Okay.
I mean, I think any architect will tell you that there's changes made between design development and construction documents.
That seems like a factual change, so I'm not going to look for people's approval, if that's okay with everybody.
That's fine.
I guess I just did, but I'm not going to in a perfect world. Okay.
All right, now we have a suggestion from Tim, not just about this one sentence in the second bullet point, but to rewrite it to lay out both possibilities side by side. Does that seem as though it would be helpful?
Yeah, just the inconvenience of both for in terms of ADA compliance. The inconvenience. Both are inconvenient solutions for this particular design because of the elevated nature of the building.
Not sure what point that leads to. Does that lead to the point that it's not possible to make an ADA compliant annex? I mean, I've got Marty next, but I want you to clarify your thought.
I think the key words that I proposed were that both solutions are not unacceptable, but inconvenient.
Okay, I'm going to go around the table and see if we want to say that. I don't exactly think that
would be.
I don't know that we want.
I think that's self. Isn't being differently abled sort of self-evidently inconvenient? I mean, isn't that?
But anyway, let's Marty. What's your response to that?
I think what Tim is saying is that the need, because of the fact that you have to raise this building, therefore you need a ramp and or a lift, makes that site more problematic than this site. And I think that's what you're coming to. So it's not just inconvenient, but it's expensive. That ramp is expensive. A lift is expensive. So there's expense to be considered here. And it's what it's saying is that the need for these, for lift and or lift or ramp has a negative impact on the viability of the stream side site.
Okay, Amy.
And we know for sure that a new addition on the side wouldn't require a ramp or a lift?
Right.
How do we know that?
Because it's not in the, because it's not in the 100 year flood zone.
Because you wouldn't have to go high.
You don't have to go 3 foot above to grade.
But how do people that are in wheelchairs get in it?
It'll have some kind of
a
ramp. I don't think you're saying that it's just...
It'll have a ramp, but it may not need a 50-foot ramp.
Gotcha.
Yeah. The other point is that we also, we're going with 3 foot to grade rather than 2 foot to finished.
And there's one to correct there, right?
Yeah, so we're going, that's one change there.
So I'm looking around the table to see if we want to make that concept that Tim and Marty just proposed, that it's an extra cost to build on the 6 Library Lane site because of... access compliance. That's what I understand. That's the proposal, and we're leaving it to Eliza to.
I'll take another pass at
the language, but with that concept, and I think I see assent around the table, Marty.
I'm against
cost
it. My silence is dissent.
Okay. Well,
cost, inconvenience, maintenance on the machine, and lot coverage are four things that the ramp and or lift.
That access compliance require.
Yeah, that
those are four costs.
That took up that high.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Okay. I mean, so I think...
I mean, we say the ramp is long, and we say going with a lift alone doesn't make a lot of sense, which is what we wanted to say.
Uh-huh.
So I just...
It's okay.
I guess the thing is, if some people say, what's wrong with a long ramp?
Mm-hmm. Okay, it needs to be cleaned.
It's just a maintenance. It's lot coverage. It's bigger. It's expensive.
Okay, I'll take another pass at it.
Okay.
With the long ramp concept.
Yep.
I'll be glad to give it a whack at it if you want.
No problem. Okay. The next paragraph, which is even, I mean, the next bullet point. Even if the annex could be made larger, there are no program functions other than the multi-purpose meeting, computing, and makerspace presently envisioned that could be logically relocated. I think we should probably go with few program functions, since there are some, Joe. I mean, we could move the archival storage. You know, there's some things that could be moved over. I think it might be too sweeping to say no.
Things like storage, yeah. Because, I mean, you just don't want to have people and things going back and forth.
Right. So,
but, yeah.
So people would be more comfortable with few there?
And we could really, things that wouldn't require splitting up, like storage, could be done. But few would be good.
So the annex is being criticized for not doing something that it was never asked to do,
right?
Like hold fiction and periodicals.
Right.
Yes.
Wow. Okay.
No, the thought is if it could be a bigger, but no, it's being criticized for being across the street. Saying if it could be twice as big as it is, if you could build a 4,000 square foot thing across the street, what would you want to move out of the main building? Is the thought, I believe, right?
Yeah.
So the thought is you wouldn't want to break up the book collection.
So you're not talking about...
No, we're talking about what could you...
You're talking about...
What?
You keep saying the annex.
Yeah, that bothers me too.
So you're criticizing...
An annex would be better.
...building for not doing what we never asked it to do in the first place. But what you really mean is what Tim is saying, a building over there.
Yes. A building across the street.
So
right.
I don't know if it's fair to put it into library campus use not addressed by JSA design.
Okay, so the thought, So the thought we're trying to deal with is a separate build. The drawbacks to it being, to the nature
separate.
Of being a separate building.
And it's really made to talk about if you took the Joel Sanders design and completely changed it and made it bigger.
As others
would
have done.
Would it be that functional?
But it isn't the Joel Sanders design, so
right.
We could consider changing this heading to say that it's about the 6 Library Lane site.
Could be about
a critique
right,
of the 6
across the street.
Right, library campus.
We could change annex and make it.
I'm talking about even changing the heading up there, up at the top of this section that starts off. It's a section about the JSA annex.
Right.
Marty, I have your name in there.
Okay. it's about this.
I knew that it was in response to Amy, but okay, I'll wait till Eliza seems to have captured that concept, and then Marty, go ahead.
I think there's always been this confusion about the Joel Sanders design versus the Streamside site or 6 Library Lane, and I think we really have to, throughout this report, separate those two things, because they really are entirely separate. And it might not just be in here, but it would be in things like when I wrote this zoning report, I spoke about the Streamside site, not really about the Joel Sanders design. I kept calling it Streamside site. So I think we have to be really scrupulous to try and make sure they're divided.
Okay. Well, the first thing is we're not calling it the Streamside site, we're calling it 6 Library Lane.
6 Library Lane.
And I think that's a very good suggestion, and I will address that. So the thought is okay, the idea of a separate building has there's not a lot of logical things you'd want to move to a separate building, but it needs to be made clear that this isn't a problem of the Joel Sanders Annex. It's a problem of any building that's right. not connected to the main library. People are okay with that mm-hmm. concept. Okay, so that seems like an organizational thing that mm-hmm. I can straighten out.
Yeah.
Okay.
So what?
Moving along. Are you ready, Tim, to move on?
I just had a question here about these three bullet points under D1. One of them is very specific to the second bullet point is very specific to the JSA design. The first bullet point is talking about the small amount of program space in the JSA design. I'm just reviewing this to make sure that this all has that its lead-up paragraph. The FTF spent considerable time considering options to remedy the lack of actual program space design provided by the JSA design.
I think we just decided to not make it the JSA design, but the 6 Library Lane site.
So is that what we're putting in that lead paragraph just before the bullet points then? The actual program space?
No, I'm
space?
Breaking out the third bullet point is going to be broken out into another section that's an issue good. Of a building, of any building across, that's not connected to the main library.
Sounds good.
But the same is true of the second bullet point.
And
that's
the first.
Any. And the
okay.
first.
Yeah.
Any of them.
Okay. Okay,
well, the
I'll take another pass at that.
Is, the second bullet point is JSA, the clearing, the elevated nature of the building.
But Marty's point was that any building there
any
would
building
have to
across
be elevated,
the street
and therefore
elevated,
have those
right.
same issues.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Other than the footprint.
Yep, I'll take another pass at that.
Okay.
Right
nobody
on.
Had a problem with Section 2. there were some thoughts, some problems with Section 3. Stuart, you I think you were the one
yes.
of the people who raised an issue with that, so why don't you speak to that?
I think that it's a complicated thought that is too compact in this paragraph. It's attempting, at the end of the paragraph, it's comparing the increase in operating costs if you build a small building, an annex-sized building, 6 Library Lane, plus a 3,000 square foot, a smaller addition on the north side. It's comparing the increased operating costs for those two with the increase in operating costs for a larger addition on the back. And I'd like to have that clearer. It's the paragraph starts as though you're going to compare the cost, the increase in the operational cost between the annex design and the large addition on the north side. And then at the end of the paragraph, it makes that other comparison.
Right, because we felt like it was apples to oranges when it was comparing mm-hmm. a small building. We couldn't say with any clarity that a small separate building would have higher operating costs or lower operating costs than a large attached building.
Mm-hmm.
But we felt comfortable that we could say if they were the same, if you were comparing equal spaces, so you mm-hmm. would be comparing a medium-sized addition and a small separate building to the operating costs of one large mm-hmm. addition. And so that's what we were trying to get across, but it's, you're right, it's a complicated thought.
That if that section began the way you just began, if you were to build the same amount of space in two separate buildings or two separate additions or one larger addition, we think that the operating costs would be lower in one larger addition. It is
simpler.
One thought, and I think that I think you could say it that way, and I think that that's...
Yeah, I think agreed. We put it at the end, and it should be put at the beginning for okay. clarity.
And then, yep. And then take out the reference to the annex.
Right.
So that it doesn't more look as though you're talking about
gets
the
back
operating
to any
costs
building,
of that.
Right, mm-hmm. gets back to any yeah. building across the street.
Okay. I agree with Joe, putting that last sentence in yeah. the front will
right.
we'll clarify
take another pass at that.
Did we skip over two?
Yeah, there were no comments
on okay. So before we get to summary, I'd like to insert an observation
also,
about.
Also, both had comments on three before we
okay.
moved on.
All right. Are you on two, Jim, or where are you?
No, I'm fine. If there are other comments on three, I'll say what I had to say.
Okay, let's stay with three. Amy and then Sean.
I'm not sure if it's appropriate for the FTF to decide that additional staff won't be needed if we add a 6,000 square foot north wing.
We're not saying that.
Okay, additional staff and other... But you're saying we would definitely need it if we maintained a separate building, but it would be more cost-effective.
Oh, we're definitely not trying to say... We're saying operating costs are going to go... And we're saying operating costs includes additional staff. That was
okay.
the same. So I'll make that more clear. Yeah, that we're definitely not saying
okay.
that. Yeah.
Sean.
I just want to hold out that... I'm okay with this section under a rework staying mm-hmm. in, but that I'm actually not, I don't feel qualified to make that assessment
mm-hmm.
from a staffing standpoint, and I actually don't think that it's
you
potentially
think
we
should just
true.
Take it out?
So it would feel best to me if this was taken out, because it really feels like more like a staffing
ground.
Study or an operations study that really
mm-hmm.
not what we're tasked to do.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So shaky
ground. I don't know,
we're
it just kind
of
feels
scope.
Like, yeah, I mean,
yeah,
like...
Folks.
Yeah.
So
do you want to stick just operating costs?
As in heating, cooling, and ventilating.
Yeah, and maintenance and lifts.
Yeah.
And
you had. I don't know. I'd be fine at which you know. Yeah. I'd be fine putting something in there, which is saying we understand that you increase square footage, you increase operation costs. Period. You know, it's like it's staffing and you know,
right.
building management.
But I think the point is that if you have a large addition, you're going to increase operating costs. Because you're going to have now you've an elevator and you're going to service it and all that.
Mm.
But if you split the functions between two buildings and both of them have an elevator,
correct? Sure, your volume
I mean,
surface area ratio is higher. You all get
so that's
that,
really
so.
What the paragraph is about of two buildings to get 4,500 square foot versus one.
Capiche. So I feel much more comfortable, like you're saying, focusing on the operational costs and holding out the sort of operating costs argument for keeping it into one space. But I would
mm-hmm.
prefer to not wade into staffing at all.
Okay.
Okay.
I think that sounds like a good idea. How do the rest of you feel about that?
Yeah.
Marty?
I feel fine about it. I'm afraid I have to change direction here for a moment.
But you're staying with number three, right?
Staying with number three, but I just want operating expense and keeping expenses low. This is a discussion of the annex. Have we discussed in the main building keeping operational costs low? I'm sorry, Stuart. I know it's not about three, but I just want to be assured that when we spoke about the potential addition, that we have the opportunity to reduce operational costs, i.e., heating costs and so forth. Was that in there, Joe? It was not.
No,
I don't think it's specifically in there, but I think it's implied that any addition would be cost effective, and we talked about both in first
make,
cost and life cycle
no,
costs.
I meant making this more efficient by taking eliminating the HVAC that's in the cellar and locating in that other building. I know it's
right.
off topic to a degree,
yeah.
but
I don't think it's going to help a huge amount, because a lot of eliminating what you have in the cellars allows you to fix the water problem.
Okay.
And I think that the heating system and all that may be slightly more efficient, but the real issue to make this building better is when you have space to do renovation projects in here and insulate the walls and be able to you decompress and you can corner off some rooms and do energy efficient upgrades, like insulation, that's what'll help a lot more.
Okay.
So.
I'm sorry, Sue, that was all the stuff.
I thought it was helpful, Tim.
I think I do have a Marty, what you brought up is actually pretty relevant. I'm just looking through this entire section, which is basically a needs section. Goes through methodology used to determine needs, which I want to revisit in a minute. Almost everything in this section, the entire needs section, deals with space requirements, and all of a sudden, down at the bottom, under three, we're starting to talk about operating costs. So we're talking about program space almost through the entire document until we get to ADA, the ADA bullet point in D1, and we start to talk about that. If we're going to talk about the methodology we use to determine needs, we're going to start talking about program needs, and then at the end we're going to start talking about operating needs. Somehow the overall balance of this section seems like almost operating everything but program needs and ADA compliance on one paragraph is being sort of shunted to the side and taken care of in this one paragraph. We're starting to talk about what it's going to cost to operate this building, a larger north side building, or the annex. And this whole comparative thing that we did a good deal of comparison of this when Joe and Eliza and a lot of the other people in the early building committee got together. We talked about this. So to all of a sudden sort of cram all that into this operating costs section, this one paragraph, seems to me to be under addressing the matter. Either this needs to be put to a section that's more directly related to operating costs, or we need to expand this section so that when we open up talking about program space needs under methodology, review the 2007 document, review estimated additional space needs, then additional meeting space required, then we talk about parking, then we talk about program footage provided under the JSA design. By the time we get down
here... Can you make a suggestion of what you think would be the best thing for us to do?
I would suggest that we show in some way that would show in some way what the comparative operating costs are. If we're going to talk about operating costs of the JSA design, then we need to talk about the operating costs and maintenance costs of the existing building and of an attached
Okay, we're not talking about the operating costs of the Joel Sanders design. We're talking about comparing the operating costs of a separate building. This goes back to that we're going to be stressing mm-hmm. that it's about any separate building. Mm-hmm. So we don't know what those operating costs are, and we don't know what the operating costs of a building that we don't know the size of behind the library is either. So that all seems very speculative.
Mm-hmm. Maybe it'd be clearer if we made that its own section, so under needs, and this is need to keep operating costs low, instead of having it under the Joel Sanders design, you know, things not addressed, we just make it E. Need to keep operating costs low, no matter what it is. And don't change anything. It's standalone pretty good. Uh-huh. And then the summary would be F.
Yeah, it qualifies as good. A separate need. Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Mm-hmm. All right. Barry?
I don't know if I completely agree with that, because the building across the street would be much smaller than the building in the back. The building in the back was going to take more energy to heat it and cool it. We also have not talked about it all tying it into this building. So it's going to be somehow or another either connected to what already exists here, or we're going to move something into that building. But there needs to be, whatever the space is, whether it's 100 square feet, the connection between the building in the back and the main building, that's also has to be heated and cooled as well. It's a much larger space than just the building in the back. Theoretically, a smaller building takes less energy to heat, especially if it's built efficiently, than, you know, a 2,000 square foot building would cost much less than a 6,000 square foot building.
Yeah, but we're not comparing a 2,000 to a 6,000.
4,500 square foot.
It's still 4,500 square feet is still bigger than 2,000 square feet.
Right, but we're not comparing, remember, we're saying the comparison isn't apples and oranges, 2,000 to 5,000. It's 2,000 plus 3,000, two separate, you know, a medium-sized addition and a small building across the street compared to one big addition. We're not comparing a small building across the street to one big addition. We're matching up the square footage. That's the fundamental premise behind our comparison.
I still think building something on this side is gonna be, cost more to heat because of its attachment to this building.
Okay, but in order to get the same square footage, something is gonna have to be built attached to this building regardless. So that problem is gonna come up on either side of the scale.
Yeah.
So what's your point then?
I was just thinking theoretically about how, heating a smaller space as opposed to heating a larger space.
Okay, but you're comparing, then what you're saying, we're comparing one big building that's attached to this building to a smaller building attached to this building and a separate building. The attachment happens either way. So that seems like a wash when you're weighing these options.
All right, if you think so.
Well, am I not being clear?
No, I mean, you know, one of the interesting things about working in a group, in a committee, is that people have different frames of thought as to why they like certain things or not like certain things. I mean, if we all thought the same way, we'd not be individuals.
But we're trying to come up with a factual statement. So if you feel like my facts are wrong, that we're comparing a small building across the street, am I not phrasing it?
No, I understand what you're saying. I think what I'm disturbed about is that this information, is facts, and it's theoretical, but it's not the pragmatic solution. It's just, it's giving you, well, if you do this, you can get this. If you do this, you can get this. I mean, that's basically what this is reading to me like.
What would you suggest?
A broader stroke. In other words, without all the details, just to describe the conclusions in a broader stroke. Because you're...
We have asked Eliza to rewrite this paragraph in the light of the conversation we've had about that kind of thing. And I think that may be a helpful suggestion too.
A broader stroke?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay.
Marty, is it done? Okay, I think we're through with what is now subpart E.
Yep.
And on to F, the summary. I have a thought about F, the summary, and that is the third bullet point down. I propose removing that. We talked a little while ago about whether it would be conceivable to move other library functions outside of the main building. I think that it is possible, and I think that's a library program question rather than a site design question. So I'm proposing that we just remove that bullet point altogether.
It's okay with me. How do other people feel?
This one about, you're talking about the not restricted to a single library function.
No, there are no other library functions.
I'm talking about...
Oh, I'm sorry, I missed a bullet.
Third one down. I don't think it's an important observation that moves our report forward. Marty, you wanna speak about that?
What was the fourth?
Wait, we're trying to decide the third one.
Could we stick with the third one for just a moment until we get consensus to keep it...
People wanna weigh in on that?
I think if you leave the fourth one, you don't need the third one.
Okay, so I think we have agreement to take out the third one.
Okay.
Now, about the fourth one, Marty, what would you like to...
The need for more program space is not restricted to a single library function. All areas need additional space. This is not comparing the 2007 report, because I noticed that in the program, the 2007 report asked for 400, or 600 feet for computers, and this one says 400 and something. So there's a reduction. So this is...
back of the envelope estimates.
Yeah, granted, back of the envelope, but this is not saying that these are changes from the 2007 report. It is saying that all functions need more space, and that is correct?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, but you're talking about, now you're not talking about 07, you're talking about existing in the building.
Yeah, I wanted to.
Right.
The 2007 report asked for certain increases. Amy's asked for certain less increases in certain areas and more in most. But I think this is correct because this is saying in the absolute, from what we have right now to what we need, everything needs more.
And right. You know, I'm usually the one who jumps in with qualifiers. Every time I look at this sentence, I want to add virtually all rather than just all, but. Amy, you're the one.
That's more accurate.
If you feel all is all, then I'll stick with all. I think personally, the library director needs a smaller office, not a bigger one. So you know.
It does, and she prefers it with a hole in the ceiling.
Yeah. No, you need a bigger hole, but a smaller office. You comfortable with all? You know,
without a ceiling.
You're comfortable with that statement.
But the director's all.
Yeah. Okay. Great.
Just leave it all. Done.
Okay, so we're eliminating three. Can we move on to the next section? Approach and analysis.
Just a second before we move on to the next section. Well, I have a question. That is, when we do have our report final, will it be available to the public at the same time it's available to the library board? Will we publish it on the web and there it is? Or what is our idea about that? Marty?
Stuart, we report to the board, the library board. The library board decides what to do with our report. They can put it out the next day if they want. Mm-hmm. But I don't think we have been empowered in our charge to publish our findings or anything, or have open meetings or anything. So I think the library board decides that, not us.
Yeah.
That's your problem.
So I would assume. Okay.
Then I'm sure.
It's not my job.
I'm going to check with our director, but I'm pretty sure it'll go onto the library website as soon as it's available.
Right here.
Well, I knew where she was, actually.
Okay.
That's a library decision that...
So before we leave needs...
Okay. We were nearly there.
Well,
this is the overview. This is the... This is an establishing shot. We just happened to cut it at the end of the film.
What I'm hoping, though, that you'll make a specific suggestion for what you'd like to
the
change.
The suggestion is this.
Uh-huh.
We've got a section called needs. Mm-hmm. We've got a section, subsection called A, methodology used to determine needs. So I'm assuming that number one means that one of our methodologies was to review the 2007 document, correct? Then number two was that somehow we estimated, the reading of this is just a little bit unclear. I would like to see these titles jiggered a little bit so that they can be easier to understand. Because item three, additional meeting space required, looks like a recommendation.
Didn't we drop that?
What?
Didn't we drop that?
No, we're just rewriting it.
Oh, that's right. We rewrote.
We're rewriting it.
We rewrote it. Okay. Sorry.
So here's a recommendation about additional meeting space required. This is all under a section called methodology used to determine needs. Mm-hmm. I would say that the review of the 2000 document was a methodology, and then some other action or some other review that we did was in 2014 established additional space needs, but. So we reviewed, the methodology we did used was a review of 2007 and then a presentation, a review, an assessment of additional space needs.
Yeah,
another title for that would be helpful.
Looks and like B is already missing.
Yeah, we deleted it.
What is?
There is no section B. Right. That you're proposing a section B, a heading B, and I think it's a very good idea.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think additional meeting space required is section B.
Okay, I'll take another look at the headers and the format. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thanks, Tim. It's a good catch. Beyond methodology. Now we're on to section 5, FTF approach analysis used as basis for recommendations. Eliza, you want to lead us as you have? While you're looking, let me remind you that it's now a couple minutes past 7, and we're somewhere near the middle of this. We're about page 12.
The only change that I made was in the last paragraph of the very last part of this section 5.
That's good.
I changed such a building could provide, not would provide. That's the only change that I had suggested to me.
Okay.
Everybody saw the charts. We were going to add some
charts.
I
saw these two.
Right.
And the tables, the other
one. Yeah. Those are going to have a little more explanatory text on them. Does anybody have any comments about those graphs, charts?
My comment, which I'm sure that Joe is going to fix if he's putting in more detail, is it says it's a graph of cost per square foot of program space, but it ought to explain the number of square feet or that kind of thing, because otherwise it shows that a 455 is smaller than 1,200.
Which is definitely true.
It gives it a little...
Right. But it is an attachment to a paragraph. It's not a standalone document.
But I'm hoping that it'll be written so that if it's...
Yeah, but it's going to be a separate page. It's going to be the next page.
And right, taken
so
out.
I will add
great
text to it.
Anybody want to say anything else, or can we move on? I think Joe would like me to point out that he wrote that section, and it has the fewest changes. So.
Nice going, Joe. Yeah. So that brings us, that was a good move, brings us to 6 funding.
I don't think anybody had any thoughts about the part A. And I think part B is essentially the same. Stuart, I had a question. You and Jerry had gone back and forth on email about possibly adding some more work on bonding. Are you intending to link to a document on bonding or not?
I don't think so. I think this is enough.
All right.
It's a really technical paper on bonding, and I don't think it needs to be part of this. Marty had a comment, though.
A question based upon what Jeremy had indicated to me on the telephone about the cost of bonding on various levels or various construction types,
mm-hmm.
Indicating that you can bond for 10 years on a frame building and 25 on a masonry building, a metal building.
I think the library will know that when...
The library will. It doesn't have to be mentioned in here.
That's what I think.
But it does lend credence to the point of building a new structure. I don't know. I wanted to bring it up and just remind everyone about it. I guess it shouldn't be incorporated here, but it really struck me.
Thanks.
I have one question about this. I was reviewing my notes on potential frequently asked questions, and one of the things that has come up a lot is, don't you guys know that you're risking, if you don't build the annex, you're risking the grants that have come from the New York State Public Library Construction Fund? Is that what it's called? Yeah. So I added a FAQ about that, but it's possible that people would want that addressed here, under grants, number 2. I hate that we almost got away clean, so it's not to my interest to bring this up, but if somebody feels like this needs to be addressed here, we can try. The problem is, what I essentially came up with as an answer for the FAQ is, we don't know. It's complicated, and Amy hasn't gotten clear answers. It's not a criticism of you, the person, and there's too many unknowns for us to address this issue, which is why I put it in the FAQs rather than in this section.
Yeah, it feels
I think it I was going to say, yeah.
It feels like something that the board's going to have to deal with, but then it's
okay.
Not really. It doesn't have to be addressed by us, since we don't have enough information to address it anyways.
I think you should refer to, though, not Amy, but the library board has not received. If you wrote it in...
Well, when we get to it, sure. Okay, but you're comfortable with it not being addressed here.
Keep pushing the terms. The library board, it's not Amy that's received.
Last chance to speak. We move on?
Mm-hmm.
All right.
Section 7, feasibility of construction projects. When I see a heading laydown area, I have a sense of who might have written at least the first...
Joe's very happy with this section. He proposes no changes.
How much time do we have?
Where we take naps.
Right? Nobody had any comments about that section.
It's not a very exciting section.
Yeah. Now we're getting to the fun ones.
Are we moving to 8 then?
Yes. The first change to 8 is that it's titled Additional Thoughts, not Additional FTF Thoughts, or however I had it before. Additional FTF Thoughts and Ideas. It's just Additional Thoughts. It's become a little bit more of an editorial page, I guess, where people, things that we didn't cover necessarily, the body of the document, and people can say whether or not this is a good idea or not, but this is where we, I was very specific about who was proposing these things, and it's an opportunity to say things that you don't feel like were addressed in the body of our document, which we tried to stick to to really the specifics of the FTF's mission statement.
Ah, now I understand what you're asking for.
Uh-huh, Marty, go ahead.
I think it's an excellent idea to allow a little bit of individual input, not lengthy, but a few sentences about what our individual concerns are about the project. I think it's really needed, and it allows that freedom. And it's taken for what it is. Mm-hmm. So I like the idea of being able to say a couple of little words about what you really think.
What about making this and Section 9 FAQ as appendixes? And so that the FTF report stops just before this, and then this is attached to the FTF report as a way, so that what I'm suggesting is that in that way the 12 members of the FTF don't have to buy into or review everything that's said here. The FTF report stops just before this. So I'm offering that as a...
I think that's a good suggestion.
And so then these would come after all the other linked documents?
Well, or before. They can... I didn't say Appendix 1 or Appendix 5, but...
No, I'm not... Yeah.
Call them appendixes rather than sections, is my concept. And Eliza is thinking, and then I'll get to you, Marty.
Okay. Go ahead. I'm thinking.
Don't think.
It takes me a long time to think.
I think we could name it something like individual thoughts or individual comments. Or individual positions, however you... additional thoughts and ideas... Additional individual FTF thoughts, or individual instead of FTF. These are not FTF member thoughts.
I'm not sure that the FAQs... I think the FAQs are being answered by the group.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas these are not.
Yes.
So I would suggest maybe... At the end of the FAQs, did you guys agree about everything? And we say, no, why don't you see appendix for some individual thoughts?
Mm-hmm.
How about that? And have section 8, the additional thoughts, be the appendices and the frequently asked questions end our formal document.
If you want to publicly hang our dirty laundry that we don't agree on everything.
I'm not, this is pretty non-controversial stuff I put in here, which begs the question of, are there things people want to add? All right, so that's my pitch for it.
Well, I'm looking around the table. What do you all think? Seems like it could be a sensible way to go.
Mm-hmm.
It's fine.
I didn't hear that last thing. I was
She's saying put the FAQs as part of the report, and then this is the separate.
An appendix.
And have an FAQ be...
With the links from
And
here.
Have an FAQ. Yes. Did you guys seriously agree about every single thing? And the answer could be, well, no. And we talked about a lot of things that aren't necessarily on point, and here are some of them, and then we link to appendix for additional thoughts.
Mm-hmm.
But it would essentially be the same format of, naming the person and the thought. In one case, there's a rebuttal. Maria, we're linking to Maria's inspirational architecture thing, and then Joe says, you know, he'd like to note that while he agrees that architecture can be inspirational, the North Wing, the focus should be on function, not inspiration. That, you know, save the inspiration for something you can see from 212.
I'm hoping for inspiration on the inside, too.
Yeah.
But, definitely.
I don't know if Joe thinks that's not possible.
No, I think the things, what you don't see, you save money on. What you see, you spend money on.
Mm-hmm.
You know? And then,
anyhow, are we okay on this format change? Because if so, then let's go down the list. Do you want to lead us through either this or FAQ?
Well, so...
We could take a look at this list.
All right, yeah.
Anything
I've heard from, I feel pretty solid about the first couple. Amy, you want that thing from the Future of Libraries to be both from you and Esther?
I don't know if Esther's going to want to put her name on it.
Right, okay.
And I can't get in touch with her to find out, so.
Okay, change that.
You could take out erudite, though.
That's my editorial comment, and I'm keeping it in there.
Okay.
So, tough. You're going to take the compliment, and you're going to like it.
All right.
Okay, so Maria, Joe. Marty, you had added one. Marty wanted to add a thing about, and, you know, just that'll be up to you. So we'll go over it separately. You had this thing. Tim, you were going to write up a thing about, you'd like to talk about the lessons of Socrates, and then you wanted to call for better, I was speculating that you wanted to write something about that.
FAQs, aren't we?
No, we're on additional thoughts.
Okay, great. Back to that.
You had earlier asked for an opportunity to speak to better communication, how to, you know, the idea about the marketing, the plan to the library. It's up to you if you want to do it or not, but whatever it is, it needs to get in here soon.
I think that what you're referring to is the thing that I put in the original executive summary that I sent you, and that had a unity section on it, and I can use some of that.
Well, you spoke to the... You chaired the communication subcommittee, mm-hmm. and on Joe's outline from 3 weeks, a month ago, mm-hmm. you were going to write up a thing about marketing the plan to the town.
Oh, I see. So, I think Jerry and I are
have a little bit of order
on that together if we're going to do it. So let me talk to Jerry about it. And Barry, you were on that committee too. If you, mm-hmm. you know, maybe we should just go around. And we'll see whether we can include something in here in the next couple of
weeks. Sean, is there anything you'd like to write up about never volunteering for anything? Or?
Sure, yeah.
Never again.
Okay, so that's up to you guys. It's sort of an editorial page, so if there's things you want to speak to, it's got to come in by the end of this week. We just are out of time.
Well, I was going to wait a few minutes to talk about deadlines and next meetings and stuff, but if you want
to
say...
I just like to make them up.
Yeah,
thank
well,
you.
Making it up is fine, and then checking it around the table is how we're going to make it solid. And so, shall we talk about that now, or should we go
on
to
FAQs? Let's do the FAQs.
Okay.
Let's do FAQs.
Thanks.
Okay, we're...
I've just got to say, treehugger.com, sustainable product design, stop with the glass facades already, is one of the greatest links I've ever seen. Stop with glass facades.
I wonder
if... one of the FAQs here.
One of the FAQs?
It's one of the links in the FAQs.
Okay.
Very funny.
Any?
I mean, really? That's really one of the questions? The floor-to-ceiling glass panels?
People sent me questions, and
okay.
I put them in the FAQs. We can take them out.
People.
I mean, are we going to put in a question about how come there's no curtains too?
Or what color?
We can discuss.
Which
we can discuss.
Criticism we never even got.
No,
to talk
we can
about
discuss
curtains.
Whether or not to have these are. This
so,
is the draft.
Right.
This is where,
okay.
This is the time to discuss whether these should be in here or not.
Okay.
So.
I don't think that should be in there, but.
Then,
that makes sense to me too. It's.
I would take that one out. It's being a pain in the ass.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Others, what do you think about? I don't even see it, but I remember seeing it, and I thought that it was...
Are floor-to-ceiling glass panels considered suitable for electronic media and
is.
Energy efficiency? Not usually. Here's another thing to consider.
Uh-huh.
We have enough in here.
I think it's pertinent, it's interesting, but it's not necessary.
Yeah,
it's not forward-looking, you know. That was sort of about,
yeah, but it's more
about the old...
I think it's a valid criticism of annex that doesn't need to be done.
Okay.
A cheap shot. We'll take it out.
All right.
We're only gonna go with expensive shots.
But I do wanna go to that URL though. Stop with the glass facade.
Okay. First one is, why not just build an entirely new library? Mm-hmm. We're gonna link to the, because it costs $7 million chart that I don't have, that I didn't bring, mm-hmm. but I will send around to everybody. Everybody okay with the second question?
No, wait. On the first...
Well, go ahead.
On the first, we believe that an entirely new library building is too expensive to build at this time. Is too expensive to build, is beyond, I would think it would be better to have said, is beyond the desire of the community at this time, or something of that sort. It's not too expensive to build at this time.
I don't think we know yet.
Interest rates are at record lows, and I don't think we can say it's too expensive to build at this time.
I think
it's too expensive for the appetite of the client.
Right. I think what we're saying is, if we had no phases and we had an entire new library right now, we'd wind up with $7 to $10 million. And even if we had grants and donations, we'd wind up with a huge bond. And we believe it'd be too much at this time for the town to agree to.
For the town to agree to. I agree with that. I agree with that point. But this is not that. This is just saying it's too expensive to build at this time. That indicates that it's 18% interest rates.
Yeah, it's just the town at this time to agree. Maybe it needs to be two phases, whatever.
Your
point's well taken. It's not too expensive. It's too expensive. Too much of a bond issue at this time for the town.
It's our opinion.
This is the FTF's why we're not recommending a new library.
Yeah, it starts out, we believe.
But the last sentence, or the next to last, Woodstock simply doesn't have a large enough tax base is incorrect, and we really ought to take it out.
Okay.
Right.
Woodstock has a bonding capacity of around $100 million and outstanding bonds around $5 million.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And so...
Great.
All right, I'll rework that. Mm-hmm. Okay, second question.
Gary Fisher, signing the library.
Mm-hmm. Nobody had any... comments about the second question? Anybody have any?
It's pretty long.
Let's move right along. If we have silence, what about the third? And that is to say, I'm looking
silence
at the clock.
Well,
is why
the idea was to have read it before you got here.
That's right. And I'm assuming that that's...
Okay.
And if somebody says,
we
didn't read it and I want to read it over again, we'll stop. But otherwise, I'm going to keep moving us along because it's 7:20.
Obviously, the next question we haven't answered yet. I'm not sure that...
I think it's a good answer.
We're not... Yeah.
That's one of my favorite answers. On
you
that.
Just want to go with that?
Just say yes.
We're going to take a look at this one.
Yeah.
What is TK?
To come. Misspelled on purpose.
To come.
Do people want... is this something that's too complicated we want to take out? Is it something we want to... talk about what we want. I mean, I thought this was where you talk about charrettes, you talk about outreach. We're defining what a master plan is.
Well, I could take a crack at that.
I think defining what a master plan is good. I don't know if we can agree on the cost or the time.
Yeah.
Okay, so explain what a master plan is?
Yeah.
Okay.
Then I heard.
Can you do that, Ben?
I can do that.
That's a better question.
All right.
Okay.
What is a master plan update? Because that's what we're calling for.
Right. It's not from scratch. It's
Okay. Marty.
Question on this. The reader of this, are they, is a reader of this wanting to know what to expect from a master plan at this point? In other words, if I'm reading it...
it's up to us. What do we want to tell them? Who knows? Different
What is the questioner asking, and what is the correct response to it?
Mm-hmm.
I think we've said when you say that depends, it means it can be this or it can be that, and maybe in the response, it should say it can be this or it can be that.
I think we just changed the question to what is a master plan update?
What's involved in updating a master plan?
Right.
And we'll see what he comes up with, and then we'll criticize it.
Send it over by tomorrow.
Everybody okay with... nobody commented on the buying local part. Nobody made any comments, about 2015 versus 2007. Very minor changes to the question about speaking to Joel Sanders directly.
On 2/15/2007, mm-hmm. We contemplate a much more open, much more deliberated or open process or something like that. Something about the process could be mentioned in that question. The process.
You don't feel like the last sentence addresses that?
We also recommend much more gather input and communicate his plans with the public this time around. Well, we're recommending it. We expect that the library will make a much more concerted effort or something like that. It's good.
Okay.
Okay.
We've gotten on to parking. Is that where we are, Eliza?
Should we take out, this goes back to that question about moving things across the street. Should we take out the sentence under the, what, in the section about talking to Joel Sanders? We also tried and failed to identify any other programs that could logically be relocated to 6 Library Lane. It seems like we've said that we're not going to talk about that. Okay. Marty, did you want to...
I gave you something. I sent you something. I didn't bring it with me.
Right. Okay. Maybe the thing... this should really be part of the editorial section. I think
you don't have what I brought, what I sent?
I don't have it with me, no.
Okay, basically what I... if I might...
another FAQ?
On the parking issue. Yeah. I sent Eliza comments. I don't have it with me. I said I felt it was 6 cars. I said that the 07 report identified that the connection to the Locomo parking lot should be increased. That hasn't been done. I said we should continue to do it. I talked about you could possibly add more parking off of Lasher Lane, but that would negatively impact any buildable lot that you would have back there. I said that you could not appreciably increase the amount of parking doing it legally without backing out. In other words, you could pave the Library Lake, but you wouldn't pick up that many more cars of parking. And I suggested leaving the grandfathered perpendicular to Library Lane parking the way it is. And that, indeed, there is an advantage of it in that people can back out into Library Lane and then proceed to 12 as opposed to having to parallel park and go all the way down Library Lane and come back out Orchard, etc. So that was the gist of what I wrote.
So what I propose is that this is essentially the same. Then Martin Nystrom has some suggestions for the board on this topic, which will be covered in our first addendum, additional thoughts, and turn it into a, so that, because it seems like more of an editorial.
Right? Okay, and because I asked for a sidewalk and so forth.
Right.
Sure. Lit.
Because it was two different documents, one of which Stuart had responded to last week, saying
yes.
It seemed like outside the scope, and so that's what I was suggesting, is that it become more of an editorial.
Okay. The one I sent to Stuart talked about tying all the paving in, both Vince's, the parking, the laundromat, and our side.
Okay.
In the same design manner.
Anybody have any problems with the, why not improve the book bar instead of replacing it?
And you might add the water problem, the flooding problem as well.
Okay.
Slab floor, no insulation, no heat, occasionally floods.
Okay. Anybody have any problems with the next question and answer? Somebody had suggested putting in a thing like the library can't, we can't imagine the library could expand without the FOL. And I think I think adding that, I don't know, I had a problem with it. I'm not sure I can voice why. I felt it was sort of covered, so I didn't add that one sentence.
Marty had a thought.
I don't think you can, we, I don't think we should say will force FOL to find a new base of operations. That's saying that they're required to do it. It will require the relocation of needed FOL operations, but it's not saying that they're being thrown out on the street and need to find a place to operate. It's for the library board to decide where they would go. It's not, we'll force FOL to find a new base of operations.
But that is the, if something is built there, that is the result, right?
That function, the board will have to find a new base of operation for the FOL.
No, the FOL will have to find a new base of operation.
There's a little confusion here. The barn is the book barn. It's not their base of operations. They can meet in Amy's office. They meet in other places. They sell books out of the book barn. They store the library fair equipment in the book barn, but it's not their base of operations. Okay. It's been given to them to use.
What do you think their base of operations is?
How about if, not asking that question.
The gypsies.
But how about if we were to say, we recognize that our recommendation to build on the site of the barn will have it force the Friends to change their book sale.
Okay.
Because that's really...
I'll change something. Okay.
Or Amy. You
have another comment about...
Cause the book, not force.
Sure, cause, right.
Yep.
They were a 501c3 in 2007.
Oh, okay. They said they weren't at the meeting.
Yeah, I think that's not true.
Okay. All right.
Not according to the IRS determination letter.
Okay, mm-hmm. Cool. Good catch. Thanks.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so I'll rework that first.
They weren't around then, so they wouldn't know.
Okay, so I'll rework that first sentence. Anybody okay with this next question about relocating the book barn?
Yeah, it looks okay.
Okay, next question. The grandfathering.
Oh.
this is where I was going to put in a question about library received several grants from the New York State Public Library Construction Fund. Those grants for buying 6 Library Lane. There were 2 grants, right? Not 3, Amy?
There was 3.
No, there's been 2 so far.
Okay, for buying 6 Library Lane and for asbestos abatement during demolition.
But you have a grant for the pole relocation too. You're just not going to use that, right? Do you know?
Well, the second grant was, it was written for the asbestos abatement and the demo and moving the pole. We didn't get it fully funded. We just got some, but it was for all those 3 things.
Okay, we're contingent on the building of the annex. If the annex isn't built, doesn't the library risk having to return those grants, and won't future grants be jeopardized if that happens?
No.
And basically my answer is we don't know. It's not in there.
Oh, okay, all right, fine.
We don't know. Amy is the library's liaison with the New York State Public Library Fund. The issue is complicated. She has not received clear answers. There's simply too many unknowns for us to address this issue. Basically the way I
haven't received clear answers because we don't have a clear direction to tell them that we're going to get clear.
Okay, I add this because it seems like something that people have raised
a lot.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay, so I got to add something there. But people are okay with the idea of addressing this?
I think so, Marty.
So they can't respond until we have a positive direction.
They are waiting for the FTF to bring their recommendations to the library board and for the library board to make a decision about how they're going to proceed.
Mm-hmm.
So answer will be based will be once the library decides how to proceed.
Okay. Next question was the same. What should be done with 6 Library Lane? Then I added a question. What about the estimated $200,000 the library has already spent on the annex? Something about like on the annex project. This has come up again and again. Why do you recommend walking away from the annex project? What does that say to the donors who gave in support of it?
Mm-hmm.
Again, you know, it's a touchy one, and but people keep asking it. What I wrote, and this was just a very first pass at it that I wrote at about 4:45 today, was we believe the larger expansion plan will be appealing to donors. The library will get a lot more space for their donated dollars. 6 Library Lane is a useful addition to the library campus, and the Hartley Report is a useful roadmap for any library expansion project. So, you know, it's not like all the money was spent in vain.
Mm-hmm.
If there's other things people want to add to that or take out or, you know, there's something, as I say, I just threw this in because it occurred to me it's a question that really, you know, has been frequently asked.
Yeah.
I think that's good, because all the studies that were done are now, you know, further the knowledge of the library on how to use that land in the future, so it's all, you know, good information.
That's a good addition.
Okay. Everybody's okay with the answer about the MOU? Is everybody okay with the answer about whether or not to go through the zoning and planning board process? Or we sort of step away, say that's not our decision to make? Jerry has a great write-up on Library Lake we'll link to.
Has anyone asked that question besides the FTF? I'm considering...
Which question? Whether,
can anything be done about Library Lake? I'm considering just omitting it. I think Jerry's also already got his piece on the editorial page.
Jerry did make some progress both with the town and researching the pipe that was under there, mm-hmm. and that the town would...
Well, I think Jerry's work is good. My question is whether anyone cares besides Jerry.
Oh, yeah, I do. I think people have asked about it.
Yeah, I think it's a... I think it's something that...
All right, leave it in.
It's a contribution to...
Okay.
And then why should anybody... you're okay with that thing about the how do we know how much space the library will need? That was my...
That's good.
That's okay. Okay, and then why should anybody listen to you? That's my favorite question, and I'm not taking it out no matter what any of you say.
Mm-hmm.
And that's it.
Only Stuart cares for Jerry.
I like
it. I think the order of the FAQs is pretty good.
Yes. Okay, so we'll add a thing linking to the...
Okay with me.
I love this ring.
So, about our process, what can we expect when, and when, what shall we do next?
Well, we're up to me. This would be, could I begin? Sorry.
Yeah, I was going to just say, I was going to lead into you, or you and Joe should...
I'd like this to be our last meeting. But that's just me.
Uh-huh.
So if people don't feel comfortable handling this by email the rest of the way, we can come back and do this. We'll be doing just what we've done today again.
Uh-huh.
And won't that be a nightmare?
All right, I saw Tim first and then Marty, but keep going. I'm just making sure they
know. My thoughts are that we'd like any things you'd like added, your final reports, attachments, your thing to be attached to our editorial page by no later than Friday. Mm-hmm. I'd like to have this thing wrapped up by the weekend, by the end of the weekend.
And then you would circulate final draft.
Send you a final draft. Probably come from you, because we probably have formatted it by then.
Because you're going to send it to me,
right.
And I'm putting the hyperlinks.
Then it'll be, speak now. And again, we're looking for obvious factual errors. Anything that you think is an assumption that in fact, we haven't agreed upon, something like that. But otherwise, we're trying to avoid line editing. But, I will pass around... Prior to that, I will, anything that I tackle that's a change, we'll send around for people to see.
Would that be like respond to that final draft in 24 hours, and then it's done? Or if changes have to be made, we'll do the same? I'm looking around, and I'm taking silence as assent, and I have both Tim and Marty who wanted to speak to this process, so I won't just nail it down, but I'm trying to think of what the next steps would be and make it as concrete as possible what we're discussing, if not agreeing to. Okay, Tim?
February 5th, what is happening on February 5th? Do we have a place in there? Are all of us expected at February 5th? What's going to happen there?
The library board has said that it would be glad to schedule a special meeting to meet with the FTF and go over the report. The FTF has spoken of wanting to meet with the library board and go over the report, and the library said we'd like to see the report and have a week to look at it and then talk to the FTF about it. So that's what's proposed.
Mm-hmm. Now, can questions, if the library board comes up with questions, can these be posted ahead of time to any of us or be available to us to take a look at?
I would say that we shouldn't put requirements on the library board. In the transmittal letter, we could invite any comments
pre-comments
before then, either to be addressed at the meeting or to be addressed before. And I would expect anyone sends any comments like that from the library board, they would either send them to the whole FTF or they would send them to me and I would send them to the whole FTF. But one way or another, they'd be distributed.
Good. It just might streamline things from February 5th, and if there are a lot of questions lined up, might be a good idea to just know ahead of time if anybody wants to signal.
All right.
Signal us. Not a requirement, but.
Thanks, Marty.
I think we can call it a day. As to the changes that still have to be made or the tightening up or whatever, Eliza's done an incredible job, and I think we can...
Joe's been equal partner.
The two of you have done an incredible job, and I think your presentation has been fair to the consensus of opinion around the table, and I don't think we're going to need any further meetings. I really congratulate the two of you on it and have total confidence that you can just finish it. Let's get a rock and roll on.
Thanks,
but everybody was cooperative. I mean, we couldn't have done it without the level of cooperation we've had.
No, it's been great. You guys, everybody okay with?
So no cookies, no cheese.
I was going
like
to.
No farewell.
The
anything.
Library.
I was
going
to make something.
Okay.
Last week I was too busy to make something, and this week I would be making like phlegm cookies.
Right,
so I didn't
yeah.
think that would be tasty.
One last thing, though, Stuart, while I still
have... Amy's got the floor, and then after that...
I started with my stupid joke, but I really did have a question, which was, what about the cover letter, who's writing it, and do we get to see it before it goes to the board? And is there one still?
Right now it just says, here's your stinking report.
Oh, okay. How about...
Ta-da!
Right.
I didn't have a cover letter for it.
Okay. Ta-da!
I'll write the cover letter. The board, it's going to come to me, and if I distribute it to the board,
write a letter to yourself?
Do. Yeah, of course.
Nice.
You're
going to
sit
right
down and write yourself a letter?
Yeah.
Barry.
Dear Stuart.
Is everybody here going to be at that board meeting?
I'll be there.
I'll be there.
I think it's important.
I think we should be.
To answer questions.
And I'll bake.
Should we get a bigger place?
I think it's probably a good idea.
Well, I think the public might be there, too.
Yeah.
We might have to distribute the report at that meeting, too, a lot of copies.
Well, I don't know about that.
Are you required to?
Well, no, I don't think we're required to. We'll certainly have it on the website as soon
as it's on the website,
On the library website.
Yeah.
And how big of a printing process we want to do, I'm not sure. The director will probably decide that.
I forgot about the website.
It'll be easily linked.
22 pages. Really,
it's going to be more with all of those editorials, so that it's something like 30 or 40.
Is everybody okay, though, with the deadline? Getting back to the deadline on
Friday.
For anything else you want to add? And then we'll
like
get something
Friday
to
Friday evening? Friday sundown?
Yeah, before I go to Seder.
Okay.
Okay.
I'm glad the library board is willing to meet with us, and I think we should pass along the word that we're willing to meet with the library board.
Marty, let me say that what the library board is willing to do is have a special meeting.
It's
always going to meet with you,
okay.
And it's not waiting until February 16 or 17
But in the, I think we'll be very. Not insistive, but I think it'd be very wise for the library board to pose any questions prior to the meeting so that the various members that have had whatever background in it can research and make a viable answer. It will make the meeting more valuable. So I really encourage the library board to ask those questions prior to the evening of the function, to pose those questions.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So that can be a preamble to the receiving of the document.
And you guys, I guess the board has to decide whether or not it's going to be a publicly heard meeting.
Any questions, please bring them to the board.
Yes, we'll decide that.
Yeah. So you'll let us know where the meeting is? And
oh, yes.
All right, excellent.
You and everybody in Woodstock who's paying attention.
Okay. Is that it?
Hopefully that's all.
I'm pretty sure.
The land out, it's gonna be the land out.
Then maybe we're done tonight.
The FTF has an after party?
What I get is that we've agreed that there will be no next meeting, so we don't need to arrange the time and place of that. And meeting notes, I think that the meeting notes are on Eliza's pad, and that we're set then, and it's not even 8:00.
Well, congratulations, everybody.
Thank you very much.
Not quite finished, but we're close. There's a light at the end of the tunnel.
I know, I haven't been.
That's the square thing, you should go check it out.
Look challenging on December 30th to be finished by January 20th.
Next Tuesday, instead of this.